So in today's class, let us learn about interfacing of analog to digital converter to 8051. So the very objectives of the learning this particular module is to understand the need for ADC, the various types of ADC, and learning how to interface analog to digital converter to 8051. It is always essential for us to know the applications of these analog to digital converters in the real-time environment. So as I was telling in the beginning part of this particular module, microcontroller finds its application in most of the fields, okay, and most of the appliances rather, whether it is domestic, agriculture, automotive or health sector. In many of these devices, analog to digital converter finds its place, right? Wherever we have been dealing with analog quantities, there we do find the requirement for ADC. We know that most of the quantities which we have been dealing with are analog in nature. It may be temperature, it may be weight, most of the physical quantities. But at the other end, we have been working with the systems, okay, it could be microcontrollers or your computer, whatever it is, they are looking for something which will be digital in nature, right? So in such places, we don't need to have something in between which will be able to convert this continuously varying parameter into digital equivalent, right? So in such applications, in such places, we do would like to have analog to digital converter. For example, if you consider the example of an oven, right, you will be able to display the values, okay, you will be able to display the values like power and other things, okay, and time, etc., in the LCD in a digital format. Okay, this power and other parameters are continuously varying in nature, is it not? It varies with time, it increases with time, right? You will be able to set those parameters, and you are getting those values on the display. How are you able to get the analog values on the digital format? Is the question, okay? And you consider the electronic weighing scale, okay? As you keep on increasing the weight, you will be able to see the value in the form of digital on the LCD display or the 7-segment display that has been connected to it. Okay, so there we need to have a circuit or a system which will be able to convert this analog information into digital equivalent. Dear students, wherever we have been dealing with real-time environment and wherever we want to display something in the digital format which a human being can understand, in all such places we do need to have the analog to digital format. And it need not be for displaying, it can be for processing also, right? In all such places, we would like to have, we need to have rather analog to digital converter, right? Now, let us see how does this analog to digital converter work. Digital equivalent for the analog signal, right? So, and here it works basically on three processes, okay? One is sampling, that is at the instant at which we are going to sample the data or read the data, then we are going to quantize it. We are going to quantize it to the nearest binary equivalent, then we encode the value. Okay, so the analog signal, which is actually 1 volt here, has been converted to a digital equivalent of 001. Similarly, an analog signal whose value is 6 here has been converted to 110. An analog signal whose value is 011 here has been converted to its digital equivalent. Dear students, please do understand, this sampling is not taking place continuously. It is happening at different intervals of time. Right? And once the sampling has been done, the quantization has been done, okay, and we do encode the values. Right? So the full analog signal, which is continuously varying in nature, has been converted to its digital equivalent, having different values, and these different digital values are representing the analog equivalent, which was the original signal. Right? So this is how the analog signal has been converted to digital equivalent. Now, these are the few applications where you find the analog to digital converter. Okay, it could be your scanner, cathode oscilloscopes which you find in the lab, okay, the sensors. Okay, so in most of the places, now people do not want to have biometric sensor, they go for iris scanners or some other sensors, okay, where we will be capturing the image, right, and those sensors will be, those values will be converted to digital equivalent. Okay, and the multimeters which you use in the lab, you are measuring voltage and current which is continuously varying in nature, and you are able to get the values on the display. Right, and the function generators and signal generators which you use in the lab, right, and the automated tested equipments and portable instruments, okay, and data acquisition systems, all these systems will be having analog to digital converter embedded with you. Now, if at all we have to design a system where we would like to have a converter which will convert the analog information into digital equivalent, there we need to have a ADC. Now, our requirement is, unless we know how an analog to digital converter works, unless we know how to use it in the real-time environment, unless we know how the connections are being made with analog to digital converter, unless we know how to program an 8051 when we interface an ADC to 8051, it would be very difficult for us to design a system which would have ADC as a part of the circuit. Right? And whenever we speak about, whenever we think of the real-time environment, students, we will be thinking of the physical quantities. Once we think of physical quantities, we know that the physical quantities are continuously varying in nature. So it is very much essential for us to know the place where the ADC finds its uses and how to use ADC in the real time. Okay, this tells us the very need for learning the using of ADC in the 8051 related circuits. Right? So here is an application. Okay, let us assume we are going to design a system, okay, where we will have an automated system, okay, and the system is situated near the toll. Students, we are all in the era in which the whole globe is suffering, the whole world is suffering. Corona is a global problem, and we know that many of the problems are not because of the people who are staying in the place, it is because of the people who have been traveling across. Right? It is a problem which every person is facing. Okay, now, if you can have an IoT based system where We are having a system near the tolls in the vehicles which have been used for public transport, right? So the system should be in such a way that it should be having a scanner, okay? So it should be able to scan the temperature, and it should be able to give a display saying that this is the temperature of the person who has been entering the bus, or this is the temperature of the person who has been getting into the city. Okay, and if there is a variation, it should be able to inform the concerned authorities as well. Right? Can we have one such system? Now, if at all we are planning for one such system, what are the requirements of the system? We need to have a temperature sensor, right? And the temperature sensor or any sensor for that matter, the output whatever you have been getting from the sensor will be of very low voltage. It will be of the order of microvolts. Now, our display will not be able to display the value if at all it is in the range of microvolts. And we want the display to be in the digital format. We will not be able to understand if it gives the voltage as it is in the form of microvolts, right? Okay. So now, what do we? These are the problems that we are having at the output stage. Now, what do we need to do? What we have to do is we understand that the sensor output is of the order of microvolts, and many times it will be having some noise as well, right? So we need to have a signal conditioning circuit which should be able to remove the noise, and it should be able to increase the amplitude of the signal as well. So at the output of the signal conditioning circuit, we will have a noise-free amplified signal. Okay, but the signal is still in analog form. But our display will be able to, rather human beings are able to understand only if it is in digital form, only if it is in the decimal format. Right? So what do we need to do? We need to have an analog to digital converter. Right? So we have an ADC here which will convert this analog to its digital equivalent, and the digital input will be fed to the CPU. Digital input has been fed to the CPU. Okay? Now, the CPU will further process it, and it will send the value to the liquid crystal display. Okay, this is the general block diagram, students. The sensor could be temperature sensor, it could be your load cell, it could be a pressure sensor, it could be a moisture sensor. The sensor could be anything for that matter. And similarly, the signal condition circuit, it could be of any type that you are willing to use. Your ADC could be 8-bit ADC, it could be 9-bit ADC, you can choose the ADC of your choice. It could be 12-bit ADC, depending upon your accuracy, depending upon the precision you are going to have, you can choose the ADC of your requirements. Right? And the CPU also could vary depending upon your requirement. It may be microprocessor, it could be microcontroller, it may be PSAP, it can be any such device. Right? So this is the general block diagram. Now if you want to use the same with our 8051, then what will happen? Now, as I said, my requirement is the same. I am going to measure the scan the temperature, and I want to display the value temperature of the person on the LCD display. My requirement holds good here also. The same requirement holds good here. Now, what will I have? I will have LM35 as a temperature sensor. The output of LM35 is very low. As I said, it will be in millivolts. Okay, 8051 will not be able to understand the signal if it is in the range of millivolts. Right, so we have been using AD623, which is a preamplifier, that is signal conditioning circuit as well. Okay, the output of the ADC, normally we use instrumentation amplifier in this case. AD623 is one such instrumentation amplifier. Okay, why we use instrumentation amplifier here is it is able to take care of that offset null, all other parameters. So we do use instrumentation amplifier. Okay, so the output of the AD623, which is an analog signal, which is noise free, which is an amplified signal, okay, will be fed as an input to 0804. The 0804 will do the conversion and the digital value will be given to 8051 as the input. The output of the 8051 will go to the liquid crystal display, and you will be able to get the temperature whatever you have been feeding here at the output in the PCB. Right, students? As I said, this is a typical requirement, typical application data. Okay, as per your choice, as per your requirement, okay, this block diagram will remain the same. This block diagram is not going to change for any reason. As per your requirement, you can change the ICs that you have been using. In place of LM35, you can put some other sensor. Okay, if at all you are measuring, if at all you are using the electronic weighing scale, in place of LM35, you can put a load cell. Understand? But your signal conditioning circuit, and it is not necessary that you have to use AD623 only. You can use any signal conditioning circuit which is available in the market. But please make sure that it is able to take the input whatever have been given from the sensor. Okay, and you should be able to process that and you should be able to give the output. Similarly, as I was telling you, the ADC need not be 0804 only, student. This is a typical example. You can choose the ADC of your choice. Higher the digital output you go for, better will be the accuracy. Higher, you can expect precise output at the output of the ADC. Right? So this is a typical diagram. Right? So coming to the types of ADC, ADC is basically classified into serial ADC and parallel ADC. And these are the various ADCs. As I was telling you, you can find ADC of 12-bit, 8-bit, etc. 0808, 0809, there are 8-bit ADCs. This AD7934, 7895, there are 12-bit ADC. Okay, and you can find parallel ADCs also. The parallel ADC is 0804, 7470, 7472, MAX1198. These are all parallel ADCs. Now the question is, what is the difference between the serial ADC and parallel ADC? In serial ADC, what happens is, you are taking the input, okay, analog input. The output is given in the form of bits on one single pin. That is serial ADC. Only one pin is there at the output, and on that pin only you are going to give the output. Whereas in parallel ADC, what happens is, you are going to have analog input. Okay, the analog input is converted to digital form, just like your serial ADC. But you will be having 8 bits at the output, or you will be having more number of pins at the output. Okay, so for example, in 0804, which is a 8-bit ADC, we are going to have D0 to D7 pins at the outputs, and on all the 8 pins, you are going to get the output simultaneously. You understand? So that is the difference between serial ADC and parallel ADC. Normally, people prefer to go for parallel ADC, unless we are using that serial ADC for some communication purpose, okay, only then we prefer to go for serial ADC. Or if at all we are particular about the number of bits that we are looking for, then we go for serial ADC. Normally we prefer to go for parallel ADC. Right? Now, so within ADC, there are various mechanisms that are available which are helping these analog to get converted to digital equivalent. Accordingly, depending upon the way the conversion takes place, we are having flash ADC, pipeline ADC, successive approximation convert register ADC, dual integrated converters or dual slope converters, sigma delta converters. These are the various converters that are available. The successive approximation register converters finds maximum usage. That is very popular. Okay. Now, so in this particular topic, you have ADC 0804. ADC 0804 is an 8-bit successive approximation parallel digital converter. Clear? So it is an 8-bit converter, and it uses successive approximation registration conversion process for converting analog to digital equivalent. Okay, and it is a parallel type of converter. right? And it is, as I said, it is most popularly used converters as well. And if you can see this diagram here, students, this is the analog input that we have given. The coverage has been shown in green color, no? That is the analog input that has been fed. Okay, and it has been quantized, sampled, encoded, and you are going to have a digital equivalent. The digital equivalent will be something like this. Clear? Now, so coming to ADC0804, it works with 0 to 5 volts analog input voltage. It has one input and 8 different outputs. And any ADC for that matter, students, conversion time is a very important parameter which will help the design engineer to decide whether it is a good choice for him to go for a particular type of ADC or not. Now, in my system which I am deciding, working upon, if my conversion time is set to microseconds, and let us assume I have used ADC whose conversion time is 10 microseconds, right? Then, do you think it's worth going for the ADC which I have chosen for my requirement? Definitely not. I have to choose the ADC whose conversion time will be almost at par with the conversion time of my requirement. You understand? If it is able to do the process faster than that, it is well and good. On the other hand, if it becomes slower, then it becomes a problem. You understand? So, this conversion time is something, a critical parameter when we are choosing the ADC. Now, when we say it is a critical parameter, how are we going to decide upon the conversion time? Is there any parameter that with which we will be able to vary the conversion time according to user's requirement? Is a question. Okay, so the conversion time varies depending upon the clocking signals that has been applied to clock R and clock inputs. Normally what we do is we view the clock from the external circuit. If at all we are using 8051, what we try to do is we derive the clock from the 8051 clock itself and we try to give that as the input to the clock of 0804. That is the normal procedure we do. Sometimes what we do is we connect additional resistors and capacitors to the RC circuit of the 0804 and using those resistors and capacitors we are going to vary the clock of the 0804. That is the option, second option that we normally go for. But whatever the option you want to go for, students, you have to make sure that the conversion time cannot be faster than 110 microseconds. Okay, ADC0804 as a chip has a limitation. The limitation is whatever the input you are going to give, whatever the clock circuit you are going to give, okay, the conversion time that it can go up to is only 110 microseconds and not beyond that. Right? Now, so coming to the features of 0804, it can work from 0 to 5 volts input with a 5 volt supply, and it is compatible with microcontrollers. That is the very purpose of us for going for the 0804. And the access time is 135 nanoseconds. This is one more feature. Okay, the time required for the device to access the input is the access time. Okay, and the inputs and outputs of the circuit should be able to meet both CMOS as well as TTL voltage level specifications. That would be met because, you know, we are working with 5 volts supply and 0 to 5 volts input. So, there should not be any problem with respect to the compatibility with respect to TTL and CMOS. Right? Okay. And it has an on-chip clock generator. No zero adjustment is required. Very important parameter. When you are studying LSE, students, you would have learned that there is something called zero offset voltage. Right? Means what? Even when I make the input zero, the output will be showing some error, some voltage, and we consider that to be an error. Okay, so we say it could be because of various parameters that are there within the circuit. It could be because of the variation in the input base current. It could be because of the variation in the it could be because of the variation in the VBEs of the bases of the transistors. It could be because of the variation in the current, that is IB1 and IB2. But whatever is the reason, there will be some input offset voltage, and due to which there will be some output offset voltage also. So normally what we do is, when the input is zero, as a decent engineer, it is our responsibility to make sure that the output should be maintained zero. Okay, so normally by circuit as it is, we will not be able to give that. So we have to provide some additional circuitry so that it will be, the output will be kept zero when the input is zero. Okay, so but this is the normal requirement, this is a normal scenario. But when it comes to 0804, what the manufacturer claims is, or rather what manufacturer says is, there is no need for such zero adjustment circuit. Okay, he says when the input is zero, National Semiconductor says when the input is zero, you design engineer don't need to do any additional changes in the circuit. The circuit itself will make sure that the output is zero. So you do not need to have any zero adjustment circuitry as an external circuitry associated with this particular chip. Clear? And this particular chip comes with 20 pin DIP package. Okay, and it has differential analog voltage inputs, right? These are the electrical specifications. Coming to the pin description, okay, as I was telling you, this is a 20 pin IC. We have pin number 1. See here, one thing which you need to learn here is you need to understand which are active low inputs and which are active high inputs. In this particular case, in this particular chip rather, chip select, read, write, interrupt, these are active low inputs. Means what? If at all I want to select the chip, I have to send active low signal on pin number 1. If at all I want to read the data from 0804, pin number 2 should be made low. If pin number 2 is high, you will not be able to read the data from this particular chip. Right? If at all you want to write something into the chip, normally won't be the case. Okay, you have to make this write pin, pin number 3 should be made low. Okay, and interrupt has to be made low. Interrupt has to be made low whenever you want the circuit to be IC to be interrupted. Right? Okay. So this is about active low signals. Now we have clocking. I said we can have two different approaches. One is you are going to give the clock directly to pin number 4, that could be from the external circuitry, or we have resistor capacitor circuit combination, and that could be fed as input to pin number 19 of the 0804. You will be learning that later. Okay, we have Vin plus and Vin minus. Okay, the input whatever you are going to give, that could be fed to pin number 6 of the 0804. And at pin number 9, we have V reference. Okay, the V reference by 2 is the nomenclature that has been given here, students. We can vary the value that we are going to give pin number 9 so that the range could be varied. I will tell you how important is this pin number 9 when we are going in detail. Okay, in addition to that, we have two grounds here. Normally any IC for that matter will have a single ground. Normally it will have a digital ground. But in this particular chip, we have two different grounds. One is analog ground, other one is digital ground. The very question that any student can ask is, why do we need to have two different grounds here? Students, when we are designing the circuit, what happens is we are dealing with two parts of the circuit. One is analog part, other one is digital part. Okay, many times what happens is there will be some noise that will be generated in the analog part due to various reasons. It could be because of the capacitive effects, it could be because of the noise in the environment, it could be because of the components that are being associated. It could be the noise that are being generated in the supply. Okay, there could be 101 reasons which are responsible for the generation of the noise. Okay, now if I short this analog ground, if I short the ground of the analog circuitry with that of the digital circuitry, what happens? What are the noise that has been passing through the ground line of the analog circuitry will be passed to the ground of the digital circuitry as well. Okay, once that noise has been given to the digital ground of the digital circuitry, what will happen? It will have its impact on the additional components and the other functioning of the circuitry. Okay, many a times it so happens that it will have its influence on the inputs as well. Okay, the noise that is there on the ground will not be constraining, will not be confined to the noise of the ground. Instead, it will have impact on the inputs also. Input that signals that have been fed to the input pins of the analog to digital converter. So, because of the introduction of the noise, what will happen? So, as it is, you have been dealing with a very low voltage. Okay, and if this noise gets added, what will happen? The output that you are getting will may not be the actual output which you are expected to get on the display or whatever it is. Okay, so normally what we do is whenever we are dealing with analog to digital converters, okay, the normal procedure that any design engineer follows is he keeps the analog part circuitry and digital part circuitry. He will have an isolation between analog and digital that is in the ground. Okay, we do not connect analog ground of the analog part to digital ground of digital part. If at all we want to connect, what we do is we connect the analog ground of that to the A ground of, that is pin number 8 of the 0804. We do not connect that to pin number 10. Clear, students? Clear? So this is what, this is a precaution that we have to do. Okay. And it is very much essential whenever we are dealing with low signals. Okay. But when it comes to the lab and other things, we will not be so specific. We are not so sensitive to these things. But as a design engineer, it is very much essential for us to understand these few basic things. Okay. I always tell my students, do not confine yourself to your learning for 4 semester content. You think yourself as a design engineer. Think how you will function, how you will work whenever you are going to use this particular chip in the real-time environment, okay, where you are going to use this as a embedded system connected to working with the real-time environment. Okay, if for such requirement, you have to have a separate analog and digital ground. That's it. Okay, now we have DB0 to DB7. This is the data bus with 8-bit lines. Okay, as I said, we have VCC and that is at pin number 20, we have VCC. Right? Normally we do not have V reference will not be connected to pin number 20. Normally we connect 5 volts to this pin number 20. Okay, DB0 to DB7 is the data bus on which you are going to get the output. And DP0 happens to be the least significant bit and DP7 happens to be the most significant bit. Right? And this is about the pin description of 0804. Right? Now, I was telling you this V reference by 2 is a very important thing. Okay? So now you can ask me a question, how important is this? Why is it so important? How is it going to have any impact on the data that you are going to have at the output is the question. Now, see here, the V reference by 2, what is the pin number, students? Pin number 9, right? Can be of any of these choices. If this pin is left open, what is the input voltage range you can have? The input voltage that you can have is anywhere from 0 to 5 volts. Dear students, you know that this is an 8-bit ADC. When I say 8-bit ADC, what is the maximum value you can go up to? 255. Okay. Now, if at all you are using this as with an input voltage of 5 volts, what is the maximum value you can go up to? Is 255. So, what is the step size? Step size happens to be 19.6 millivolts. Okay. Now, on the other hand, if I'm keeping this V reference by 2, if I'm giving 2 volts to V reference by 2, the input voltage I can go up to is 0 to 4 volts. Here, students, if you are keeping this at 2 volts, the maximum voltage you can go up to is twice the voltage that you are giving here. Okay. Don't consider that for this one. For all other combination, if I am keeping 2 volts here, the maximum voltage you can go up to is 0 to 4 volts. Okay, now if I am going for 4 volts, what will happen to the step size? It is 4 by 255, the number of bits are not going to change, it is going to remain constant. So the step size is going to be 15.69 millivolts. If I am giving 1.5 volts, voltage span is 3, step size is 11.76 volts. The lesser the voltage I am giving, the voltage span that I can go is also less, 0 to 1 volt. And the step size is also going to change. It is going to be as low as 3.92 millivolts. Okay. Now, the question is, why is it so important? Is the question. Now, when I am giving the analog input voltage, I know what is the maximum voltage I can go up to. Okay. If at all I am using a temperature sensor, I know what the maximum voltage I can go up to is only 2 volts. Okay. Now, when I know that the maximum voltage, input voltage that I, for the ADC that I can go up to is only 2 volts, if at all I am going for this particular option, the step size I am going to have is 7.84 millivolts. Means what? For every 7.84 millivolts difference, I am going to have a variation in the digital output. Say for 0 millivolts, the output will be 0. For 7.84 millivolts, the output is going to be 1. For 15.6, it is going to be 2. Okay. Similarly, for 22 point something, it is going to be 3. Means for every 7.84 millivolts, I am going to have a appreciable change in the output voltage also. Right. Now, the other option that I can have is, I know my input is only 0 to 2 volts. Instead of connecting 1 volt to this pin, if I am keeping the pin open, then what will happen? The step size I am going for is 19.6 millivolts. Means for every 19.6 millivolts, it is going to change, show a variation. Now, what happened to the accuracy, students? You understand? What will happen to the, there is a variation of around 12 point some millivolts, okay, between these two values. It was showing the variation for 7.84 millivolts, but here he is able to show the variation only for 19.6 millivolts. But in both the cases, the maximum input voltage that I can go up to is only 2 volts. You understand? So, as a design engineer, I feel it is wiser to go for this particular option when I understand that, when I know that the maximum input voltage that I am going is not 5 volts, it is only up to 2 volts. So, when I understand this is a wiser decision, what I do, instead of leaving this pin open, I give 1 volt to this particular pin number 9. You understand? People, especially we people of electronics, okay, look for precision, accuracy and increase in performance. Right? So, as these are the criteria we always look for, we think it is wiser to go for this option rather than going for this option, because we already know that the input voltage span could be in this particular range. Dear students, if you are not aware what is the input voltage span that the input can go up to, then we do not have any option other than keeping the pin open. But on the other hand, if you are aware what is the range that we can go up to, it is always wise to go for the appropriate option so that we can have a good accuracy in the output. We can have more precise output. Clear? Okay. Now, coming to the parallel ADC, I said, depending upon the accuracy we want, we can go for different bit ADC. You can go for 8 bit ADC, 12 bits ADC, 10 bits ADC, 12 bit ADC, 16 bit ADC, etc. If at all I am using 8 bit ADC, what is the number of steps that the ADC can work with? It is 2 to the power of 8. So it is 256. If I am going for 10, it is 2 to the power of 10, that is 1024. If it is 16 bit, 2 to the power of 16, it is 65,536. Okay. Now, these are the number of steps which are depending upon the number of bits we are going to have here. Now, how is it going to have an impact on the step size is the question. We know that the maximum output voltage, the maximum voltage that we can have is only 5 volts. How these 5 volts could be divided? 5 volts could be divided by the number of steps that the ADC can work with. Okay, if the maximum voltage is 5 and if it is divided by 256, the step size is 19.53 millivolts. If the maximum voltage is 5 and if it is divided by 65,536, the step size is 0.076. Now, by looking at the table, students, you will be able to understand, okay, what should be the number of bit I need to go for. If my requirement, if my accuracy is not of very great importance, then I prefer to go for 8-bit ADC. If accuracy is of very high importance to me, then I prefer to go for a 16-bit ADC rather than 8-bit ADC. You understand, students? Okay. Say for example, if at all I am using an electronic weighing scale for measuring for weighing rice, okay, in a shop, right, then I will be weighing rice normally in terms of kilograms, okay. Having a variation of a few milligrams may not make much difference, neither to the customer nor to the seller, neither to the buyer nor to the seller, is it not? In such cases, I prefer to have an ADC which will be of 8 bit. You understand? Okay. On the other hand, festivals are approaching nearby. Okay. You would like to have new jewelry. Okay. And one of the new jewelry which is coming up in the city, new jewelry shop which is going to come up in the city, has given us an order and he wanted us to design a system for weighing gold ornaments. Okay, when we are designing a system for him, we understand that each milligram makes a huge difference. Right, because there in milligrams, a few milligrams make huge difference. Right, for such applications, we prefer to go for 16-bit ADC, if possible 32-bit ADC, rather than going for this 8-bit ADC. Because there, the variation in the weight, we expect the variation in the weight should be measured with the least difference, with the minimum difference, with minimum step size. Okay, for one such application, we prefer to go for the 16-bit ADC. Clear, students? Okay, so depending upon the application, you choose the ADC of your requirement, of your choice. Right? Now, as you go for higher bit ADC, normally the cost will also be high. So, you need to think of various other parameters. You think of accuracy, precision, the application, lot of parameters are there. Okay, which will help you to decide on the ADC which you want to go for. Okay, this is for you to have an understanding of what are the different types of ADCs are there and how you will be able to understand which is one which is suited for your requirement. Okay, and how will you be able to choose the ADC of your choice? Okay, these are the understanding which you need to have as a design engineer. And once you decide on the number of bit you prefer to go for, then you see the data sheet, see how many ADCs are there with this 8-bit or 16-bit ADCs. Say for example, if you have decided to use 16-bit ADC for your requirement, then you see how many 16-bit ADCs are there, okay, which are the types that are there, then you see whether they are available in the market, they see their electrical specifications, okay, see how much does it cost, okay, all those things you can find out later. Clear? Okay. Now, coming to the circuit diagram, okay, I said we have shift select read as the input. Normally what we do, we make it low because there are active low signals, we enable the chip all the time. Okay, right and interrupt pin are kept open. Okay, and we know that they are active low pins. So what we do is, we have a switch here. Can you see here, students? We have a switch. When you close the switch, what will happen? This pin will become low. Okay, so normally it will be high. By closing the switch, you are enabling the right and interrupt pins. Okay, and here we have clock R. Can you see here? So you have connected a resistor and capacitor to these two so that you will be able to get the time of your requirement. You have got 150 picofarads and 10 kilo ohm resistor. Okay, we will be able to time of your transfer. This V in plus. Okay, here we have a 10 kilo ohm potentiometer. V in plus is the pin to which we are going to give the analog input. This is a testing circuit. Here what we are trying to do is we are going to vary the resistance here. When we vary the resistance, what will happen? The voltage that you are going to get at pin number 6 is also going to vary. So when the voltage at pin number 6 is going to vary, we expect the digital data to vary, that is at the across the lines D0 to D7. If at all we are connecting LEDs to these pins, we expect the variation in the illumination of the LEDs also, right? So this is the requirement. Now we have DB reference by 2. The V reference by 2 has been left open, means what? You are able to give a voltage up to 5 volts to the input. Okay, as I had told you earlier, VCC has been connected to plus 5 volts. Okay, and we have made this digital ground to be grounded, and the analog ground and V in minus are being shorted. Now, if at all you want to give some negative voltage to V in minus, then if at all you want to give some negative voltage, then we will be able to give the negative voltage through V in minus pin of the 0804. But here we are not giving any negative voltage. So what we do is we connect V in minus to ground. If you do not do that, what will happen is it will pick some noise and it will add some value to the voltage that you have already given to V in plus. We do not want that to happen. So when we do not connect, we do not give input to V in minus, we design engineers normally connect that to ground so that we are not allowing him to assume some unwanted voltage of the input. Right, students? Okay. So in this case, we have given a potentiometer. Otherwise, what you can do is you can have a sensor, the output of the sensor after the instrumentation amplifier. The output of the instrumentation amplifier could be fed to pin number 6 of 0804, right? Okay. So, if at all you want to do self-clocking, then what we do? We use this 10K resistor, the same thing, the same circuit, whatever you have been using here. Same thing works here also. Okay. And here you can also see how 8051 has been interfaced to the 0804 circuitry. Okay. Normally, read is an input pin to 0804. Who is reading the data? 8051 is reading the data. So what he will do is, he is connecting pin number 2.5, that is port 2.5, to the read pin of 0804. Port 2.6 has been connected to that. D0 to D7 of the 0804 has been connected to the port 1 of 8051. Dear students, please do understand, we do not connect D0 to D7 of ADC to D0 to D7 of 8051. Okay. Just because it is D0 to D7, it does not mean that we connect the data bus of 8804 to data bus of 8051. It is not possible. We do not do that. Why we do not do that is, Your data bus of 8051 is the one who will be having interactions with all the associated devices. Okay, now if I try to connect this D0 to D7 of 0804 with the data bus of 8051, what will happen? Whatever the data that you are getting here will be corrupting the data bus of 8051. Okay, and 8051 will not be able to discriminate whether it is a data bus that has been generated by himself or whether he is taking as the input from the ADC. He will not be able to do the discrimination. Okay, and at any point of time, we do not want to keep 8051 in the confused state. You understand? So what we normally do is, we design engineers, we do not want to use the data bus of 8051 for reading the data of 0804 just because the name is the same. You understand? Data bus of 8051 has been used for accessing the data, for sending the data, for writing the data, and for reading the data from the peripheral devices that are being connected to. Okay, so we have dedicated port 1 of 8051 for reading the data from the ADC, analog to digital converter. Right? The interrupt pin of ADC 0804 is connected to port 2.7, which is the input pin. Right? And here we are connecting the potentiometer to Vin plus, Vin minus has been grounded. Okay? And here we are not dealing with a very critical requirement. Okay, so we are grounding analog, digital ground, we are shorting all of them, and even chip select has been connected to the ground. So all these pins are being grounded. Vin minus is also grounded because we are giving plus voltage here. Okay, the part has been connected between plus 5 volts and ground. On the other hand, if at all you had connected here minus 5 volts, then what you are supposed to do is, instead of giving to Vin plus, you should have given it to Vin minus. You understand? That time you make Vin plus 0 so that he will not get the ADC will not have error voltage between the two inputs. Right? So this is the connection part students. Here V reference by 2 has been given 1.28 volts. When we give 1.28 volts to V reference by 2, means what? What is the voltage span that you can expect? It is 0 to 2.56 volts. What is the step size? It is 10.04 millivolts. Right? That is the voltage that he is expecting at this point. Right. Now, if at all you want to give the clock to this from an external circuitry, and the external circuitry is nothing but our 8051 itself, then how are you going to do? How are you going to give the clock? That's the question. What we normally do is, we take the clock from the 8051. This is a 12 megahertz clock. Okay, we will give it to 2 D flip flop. You know the D flip flop is a, he does multiple jobs. You can use him as a latch, you can use him as a flip flop. Okay, you can use him as a divide by 2 counter also. Okay, so what will he do? If at all you are using 7.5 or 7.4 here, he will divide this 12 megahertz by 2, and this output you are going to get 6 megahertz. Again, this will be divided by 2, and you will get, and that has been given as input to the next circuitry. Okay, so see here, this has been given as input to the next, and the output of this has been given as input to the third clock. Okay, this varies. Okay, and the output of the last one has been given to the input of the 8051. This is the other way of giving clock to the analog to digital converter. Okay, so this is normally we do not use this, students, because you know this is causing additional circuitry for this. Now, if I can get the job done by having a resistor and capacitor, what is the purpose of going for 7474 and other things, you tell me? Normally, we do not use this, but this is for you to understand that there is one more method of generating the clock for 0804. You understand? This is just to understand, this also could be done. Okay, normally, we design engineers we don't prefer to go for this particular type of generating clock. So, let us see the steps that are required to convert an analog input to the Let us see the steps that are required to convert an analog input to the required digital format. Okay. Now, this is the procedure that we need to follow. Initially, we had to make chip select 0. Okay. Students, please do understand 0804 has active low chip select. Right. So, only by making CS0, we will be able to enable the chip, not otherwise. Okay, so the very first thing that we have to do is we have to select the chip, and how are we going to select the chip? By making CS0, right? Then we have to send a low to high pulse to right pin so that it will be able to start the conversion. Okay, after we do this, the analog input would have been already available at the input of the ADC. What will the ADC do? He will read the analog input and you will start doing the conversion process, right? Now, we need to know when the conversion gets over so that you will be able to read the digital output which is available at the output of the ADC, right? To know when the conversion gets over, we need to keep on pulling the interrupt pin of the ADC, right? As soon as the interrupt pin becomes low, we understand that the conversion is over, okay? That means, as long as the interrupt is high, it infers as the conversion process is going on. Once the interrupt pin goes low, it is informing the reader, rather the user, that the conversion has been completed. Right? Once the conversion is over, we understand that the digital data is available at the output of the ADC. Now, what do we need to do? We have to read the data. How are we going to read the data? To read the data, you have to make the read pin low. Okay, once you make the read pin low, you will be able to read the data from the data lines of ADC, and you can further process the data as per our requirement. Right? Once you read the data, you make the read pin high, right? So that we will not be continuously reading the data from the analog to digital converter. Clear, students? This is the steps that we need to follow. Now, let us write the algorithm for program for the same. Right? Before writing the program, let us see the timing diagram. Okay? This is the timing diagram that has been given by the ADC manufacturer, irrespective of the company, for ADC 0804. This is the timing diagram that has been given. Okay? The algorithm, whatever has been written, is at par with this. Right? The program, whatever we are going to write, will be at par with the timing diagram and at par with the algorithm that we have already written. Right? Okay. Now, so here don't think of the sequence. Please don't think of the sequence in which the timing diagram has been written. Instead, just have a look at the time at which the different instances take place. Different events take place rather. Okay? So, initially we are making CS low. Right? Then what we are trying, initially the CS has been made low, we are enabling the chip. Then right pin has been made high. Okay? Then what we are going to do? We are going to look for the status on the interrupt pin. Interrupt going low indicates that the conversion has been done. Okay? Once interrupt goes low, we understand that the conversion process is over. Now it is our duty to read the data. How are we going to read the data? By making read pin low. Once we make the read pin low, students, we will be able to read the data from the ADC. Okay, this is the sequence. Right? Now we have the algorithm with you. We have understood the timing diagram. Now we have to write the program for the same. Right? Let us write the assembly language program for this. Okay, I have written the pin diagram here. Okay, and the pin diagram consists of the interfacing of ADC with 8051. This is helpful for you to have a better understanding, right? And I have also written the timing diagram, right? So that by using these two, you should be able to write the program. Students, I always tell the hardware and software go hand in hand, especially in 8051 or any embedded system. Okay, so we need to know which are the pins that are being connected so that we will be able to use them in the program in an effective way, right? Now, so read has port 2.5 bit, read bit has been assigned with port 2.5, write has been connected to port 2.6 of 8051. The port 1.0 to 1.7 has been connected to the D0 to D7 bits of pins of ADC0804. Students, please look here. This is something critical. We have not been using the D0 to D7 pins of 8051 for ADC0804. You understand? In 8051, the port 0 is the D0 to D7 pin. Right? So we are not connecting port 0 pins of ADC0851 to 0804. The very question that you can ask is, why are we not connecting those pins to this 0804? Because even that is D0 to D7. Though it is D0 to D7 only, though the nomenclature remains the same, the purpose of using D0 to D7 of 8051 is for accessing the data from memory and other peripheral devices. If I dedicate those lines for here, then the overall functioning of the overall functioning of 8051 will go away. Right? So we do not want to disturb 8051 for any reason. We want the functionality of the 8051 to remain as it is. Okay. At the same time, we need 8 dedicated lines by using which we will be able to read the data of analog to digital converter. So what are we trying to do here? We are trying to use the port 1 of 8051 for reading the data of ADC0804. Right? I think this is clear to you. Okay. Now, so I am equating my data with port 1. Right? Initially, we are making port 1 high. Okay, port 1 is used as input port here because we are reading the data from 0804. Whenever you want to make a particular port input port, there are two ways of configuring it. One is by the hardware, you can connect pull-up resistors. Okay, you can connect resistors from the particular port pin to VCC. Right? The other way is, in the software, you can make all the port pins that you are using as input port as high, logic high. Okay, so in this particular case, we are not going to connect pull-up resistors, right? Instead, we are going to program it in the software. Right? Now, I suggest you to programming using software is a better option rather than connecting pull-up resistors in the hardware. Okay, the answer is very simple, students. Once you connect the pull-up resistors in the hardware, okay, if at all you want to use it as an output port, then you need to remove the resistors in the PCB. It is a difficult job, right? So instead, what we can do is, you can change the, or you can configure the port in the software, okay, by making the port either by setting the port bit high or port bit low, so that you will be use it according to your requirement. You understand? So normally, unless you are sure that a particular pin has been used as an input port or input pin for the whole of the working of the system, okay, I suggest you to use it, or I suggest you to configure it in the software itself rather than hardware. Clear? This is an additional observation that you need to have. Right. Now, coming back to this programming, we are making the port 1 high by setting the bits. Okay. And we are making this interrupt pin. See here, interrupt is an input pin. Right. Interrupt is an input pin that has been coming from 0804 to 8051. So, we are saying set bit interrupt. Okay. Interrupt has been enabled. Now, we are clearing the write. Okay, so write pin has become low and we are enabling the write pin. Okay, this is what your algorithm said, right? So you have to send a low to high pulse to write pin to start the conversion. Students, please do observe here. I have written the steps in the red color and the program instruction also has been written in the red color to indicate that these are the instructions relevant to that particular step. Okay, it is similarly so for the remaining part of the program as well. Right? Okay. Now, so set bit write will enable the write pin. Now, what is the next thing that we have to do? We have to call the interrupt, right? So, we are using the instruction jump on bit interrupt here. Means as long as the interrupt is high, you will be looping in the same place. When will the interrupt go low? Interrupt will go low only after the conversion gets over, right? So once the interrupt goes low, it is understood that the conversion has been done. Okay, so what will you do? You'll come to the next instruction. In the next instruction, what are you trying to do? You are going to enable the read pin. How are you going to enable the read pin? By making it low. Why are you making it low? Because it's an active low signal. Clear? Okay, so you are clearing read pin by making it low. Okay, so once you make the read pin low, the data will be available on the D0 to D7 pins of ADC 080. Now you have to read the data. Okay, where will you read the data? The data will be available here, and data will automatically come to your port 1 because it has been connected by the hardware, right? So you are going to read the data that is in port 1 to accumulator. Okay, so now accumulator has the digital equivalent of the analog input that you have given here. You had fed some analog input here, right? That has been converted to its digital equivalent. When you vary the potentiometer, when you run the program, you can see the variation in the digital pins, digital data that is available on the port 1. If you want, you can connect an LCD and you can move the data from port 1 to LCD port, and you will be able to see the variation in the data by varying the potentiometer. Clear, students? Okay. So once you do that, you will be setting the read so that you will not be further reading the data. Okay, and you will be going back to the main program, okay, to further access the data, right? So this is how the analog to digital converter works. Okay, so this is the end of ADC interfacing to 8051. Okay, I will end this particular topic with Chanakya's quote: education is the best friend, an educated person is respected everywhere. Education breeds the beauty and the youth. Thank you.